alive, you are alive.
Good morning everybody, and welcome to your live sunrise safari here from the western fringes of the Kruger National Park. We're on foot today. Gendre is on camera, he's back from leave, his vast and very impressive calves dwarfing my plover-like legs. Very nice. And we are here live. Over there is Herbert, and he is running security detail, and just beyond him are some elephants. We can hear them we can hear them breaking sticks. And so I think we'll just go and see if we can have a look. If you're wondering what on earth you're doing here, well, you are on a live safari, like I say, so please talk to us. Hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, questions at WildEarthTV if you're on the email. Also out today, Brent Leo Smith, the big loud sound. He is being filmed today by David of the luscious brunette locks. Excuse me. They're driving somewhere around there looking for big cats. Now let's see if we can get a view of these elephants. The idea behind the walking safari is not so much to view the big stuff, we do if we can, but obviously the views you're going to get on foot of the big things are not nearly as good as you're going to get in the vehicle, but it's still very exciting to go stalking up on big animals. It gives you a little bit of a thrill. I'm just going to check the wind. This is not purely for effect, I promise everyone. There is actually a reason for that. There you can see the wind is good for us. The elephants over there, so the wind is blowing from them towards us. So let's just wander through here. And I can just hear a little bit of cracking. Herbert is just in front of us there, and he's telling us where he thinks we should go. And as I explained last time, there they are. We're just going to move a little bit closer, and we're not going to get close, everyone, but we just want to get you a view. Yeah, you're right, and to check in. There. Can you see them there, Gendre? You see just a slight grey shape there. See that? Okay, come. That animal is no more than 40 meters from us. Okay, everybody, I'm going to start whispering, so be very quiet. They're just up ahead here, feeding through the woodland. The idea is we try and walk as quietly as possible. Very difficult, of course, if you have the calves of Gendre. It's like having 20-kilogram dumbbells strapped below your knees. Gendre, walk more quietly. I'm just telling Herbie where there's one. There's an elephant quite close by here. Okay, here we'll get a view. They really are quite close, only about 30 meters away, 120 feet or so. Down. Right. Okay. Look at this Dungana. I'm just asking Herbie where he thinks we should go. Okay. Come with me. We're going to use this termite mound as cover. We're going to walk around here. I think just come with us here. I think we're going to get a view here. If we don't get one round this termite mound, then we'll go to Brent. Gendre, just watch up here. Now, like I say, the idea is not to get close. The idea is not to get close and frighten the animal, or frighten us, more importantly. Wait. Okay, come straight. The idea is just to get you a view and a sense of what it is like to see an elephant on foot. Okay, here we go. We'll get you a view here. You can just see them there. You see them, Gendre? Like I said, won't be a great view. You see them feeding there. we're just going to stay here, everybody. That's kind of the best view we're going to get on foot now. We're not going to try and get any closer than that now. We'll just sit here for a little while and see if they come into the open. While we do that, I think a good idea for you to go and get an introduction from the brutally loud sound and David. We're going to wait here and see what the elephants do.
Good morning and welcome to Safari Live. My name is Bentley O. Smith, or as James Henry calls me, the brutally loud sound. Now, I am convinced, so when I went on leave, I had one glove of each. I'm convinced James Henry is hiding the other of each glove. So again, I have mismatching gloves. I have a mitt and a fishing glove, and I'm convinced James Henry is hiding that and my hat. So I've actually stolen David's hat, the cameraman's hat. As you can see, cameramen sweat a lot, but I cannot find any of my stuff, and I'm convinced that James has taken great pleasure while I've been away to hide all my different paraphernalia in different places. So it's going to take me a few days to find everything, but welcome to a very chilly Djuma private game reserve. It's about 12 degrees Celsius, which is 50 something Fahrenheit, and thanks for the updates about the lioness at the Djuma cam with the cubs. How exciting! But there are still guests there, so we cannot go in front of the lodge. So I'm doing a big wide loop. Just to let you know, Karula was also seen after drive yesterday, but she got chased by elephants, so she could have gone anywhere. So we are checking for her tracks, but first and foremost, I'm checking for the Nkuhuma and the cubs. Very exciting. So going very slowly, making sure they haven't crossed north. I think they're probably in this river system off to the right here, but it is very, very exciting. And remember, we are on a live African safari, and you can ask me questions, believe it or not, and you can do that by sending me an email at questions@wildearth.tv, or you can use the hashtag safarilive on Twitter. And I am so excited to be out after that gusting, cold, windy morning, evening we had last night. Well, the clouds are coming back slowly, but it is perfectly still. And it is just one of those mornings you're just so excited to be out in the bush. And so far we've only got hyena tracks. So we're going to check Mvubu Road. Now, apparently Mvubu Road is where the hyenas are as well. And that's a bit dangerous for that Nkuma lioness. But we're going to keep checking here, and while we do that, James, being the smallest creature in the bush, is on foot with the biggest creature in the bush.
What is so wonderful about Brentley Smith's insults is that they are so deeply original, and I've never heard them before. I'm being entirely sarcastic. This is a wonderful sighting, everybody. We're standing on the termite mound, just looking into the woodland, and I know it's not the best view of elephants you've ever had, but I want you to try and appreciate what it's like to see them on foot. We are standing on the raised sort of castle of clay built by the termites, and we can hear them, we can smell them. They can't smell us because the wind is perfectly in our favor. But look, there's an element of it's not fear, but there's definitely an elephant of thump, 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 where it's just slightly, you've got an elevated heart rate, and this is the most connected you will ever feel with the wilderness, to be standing in a place like this, looking at elephants, knowing that they don't know we're here. That to me is the crucial part of this. Now, Dave, you say, what's the story with the wind, and is it crucial? Or is there ever a time that the animals would want to be upwind of us, or we'd want them? No, it's not. Always you want the wind to be blowing from the animal to you, not the other way around. And the key thing also when you're in a situation like this is to make sure that while you're focused on the elephants over there, you're not missing the buffalo sneaking up behind you. There isn't a buffalo now. I'm just making the observation. That's why Herbert is so crucially important to what we do here. While I am focused on the lens and the elephants, Herbert is constantly looking around, seeing what's going on. This is a perfect view of a herd of elephants. Now, what we would do is move away as soon as they became aware of us. Our elephant herds are by nature probably going to be slightly more threatened than elephant bulls because they have the youngsters with us. And Nathan, you want to know if I've had any experience of being charged by elephants on foot? I've had to stand on one or two charges, yeah, but my approach to elephants is such that I generally try and avoid them or avoid them becoming aware of me. And if you do that, you're generally okay. And you also, if they were to become aware of us now, so if they were to hear my voice, and it wouldn't surprise me from this distance if they did hear my voice, they'd look up and smell, and if we melted into the bush, there'd be no problem. If we stood up on this termite mound and started making a big noise, their response would be one of two things. One, they'd move away, and the other would be that they would come towards us, or the matriarch would detach from the herd and come towards us. And you do hear horrible stories of that. And you know what? 9 times out of 10, they'll move away. But it's that 1 time out of 10 that you want to avoid, mainly because why do you want them to feel threatened? And so I've seen videos and I've been in experiences where people will walk out in front of the elephants and wave a stick or shout at them and kind of make out that the, you know, show how brave they are by chasing the elephants away. I would consider this walk a failure if these elephants became aware of us standing here, because they're peacefully feeding across here. We know they see us as predators. We know they see us as a threat. And so to make them aware of us, to threaten them in that way, would just be very unkind. We're going to try and get one more view of them, probably from around the other side of the mound. While we do that, we're going to move very slowly. Let's get an update from Brent.
So we're searching for any tracks of that Inkahuma lioness and her cubs. Now, of course, I have not seen the cubs yet, which is very exciting. And I'm hoping we do find some tracks. And I was so excited when I heard there were cubs around. I forgot to mention, Dangerous Dave is on camera. And there's Kirsten and Geraldine in final control. And it is so wonderfully still, and if we just sit and listen to the bush around us, there's only one bird we can hear calling at the moment, and it's quite often the last and first bird you hear in the morning, and it's James's favorite bird, strange enough. Oh, now we can hear a second bird. Oh, there's lots of noise in my ear. There's a white-browed scrub robin. And we can hear a grey go-away bird. Now that is an alarm call. I'm just going to take my earpiece out for a second. So, if you've been in the bush a long time, alarm calls of different birds not only give away the presence of predatory birds, but quite often give away the presence of predators. So if a grey go-away bird alarms at a bird, it's very, very different. Now, when the go-away bird actually says, go-away, go-away, that's generally for a predator. And but it's kept quiet. If we could actually see lion or leopard, it would keep going, keep going. I've just heard that the tracks of that lioness are heading south. Just listening to the game drive radio. Okay, so I've heard Aubrey's got lion tracks around Gallagher. Taxon's now got them heading south. So we're going to keep checking slowly here, because we've got to remember, it's not only the female and the cubs that were around last night. We had the Amber Eyes and that Birmingham boy, and poor old Amber Eyes was just trying to get away from him and his advances. So they could literally be, oh, That is not a good noise. Not a good noise at all. Now, apparently this all started when James ran over a stump. But let's go have a quick look in the bonnet. And while I do that, let's go see what James is up to on foot. Otherwise, I think Dave and I might be walking home.
We haven't moved, everybody. We looked around the other side of the termite mound, and this is still the best view. I think there are upward of 20 elephants here. They've been walking around through the background. You've got the little one there in shot, and that same two sub-adults that we first saw that are feeding to the left of your picture now haven't moved. They're destroying what's known as a dicrostachys bush or sickle bush. Very good elephant forage, and in areas, in this particular area especially, if you don't have elephants, those sickle bushes become horrible encroachers, and they form these thick monospecific stands of utterly impenetrable bush. And elephants, you can see, therefore, are a completely crucial part of keeping the vegetation in a state where the grazers are able to use it. I think that's the one Jandro is on now. I obviously can't see exactly what Jandro is filming. He's whispering to me, yes, that's the one he's on. Now, when I started guiding, the idea was that we didn't view elephant herds on foot. We only looked at bulls. And that was because the females can become that much more threatened, that much more easily. And that's why, this was specifically with guests, and that's why we're very careful around these ones. And these days you can do it a lot more safely than you could when I started 20 years ago. Not quite 20 years ago, 16 years ago. Because the elephants have become just that much more confiding. They've become that much less threatened by us. Especially since the stopping of the culling in 1996. This is just a fantastic shot of that little one there, learning to feed with his trunk. He's probably about, I don't know, 3 or 4 years old, I'd say. And the trunk is now fully functional, not quite as strong as it will be one day. And Kathy, you say, do elephants talk to each other while they eat? You're in Washington State. Lovely to hear from you from there. Thank you. You say, do elephants talk to each other while they eat? Can we hear them rumbling? Kathy, no, because that infrasonic rumbling is often of a frequency too low for us to hear. So I've no doubt they are talking to each other, especially the cows and the calves, but we can't hear it. We can only really hear it when they make a very loud and seemingly almost alarmed call. So when they make that, it's often a kind of alarm call. Not an alarm call, but it's a kind of stressful, let's get out of here kind of a noise. I have no doubt that they're talking to each other as we speak. And remember, animals out here speak in ways that we don't really understand quite often. You know, I think that they often speak in this kind of extrasensory way. They communicate with body language from a distance. They communicate with olfactory senses, hugely importantly, much more so than with us. That's your nose, by the way, olfactory. I'm just explaining for Jandro, because he's from Cape Town and so his brain doesn't work anymore. Used to be from Johannesburg, of course. And so while they're not always rumbling at each other, I have no doubt that they're in constant communication. Now that baby one, are you on the baby, Jandro? Okay, the baby one there, I wonder if that isn't a slightly bigger version, a year older, of Wrinkly Bottom. Because Wrinkly Bottom had a wrinkly bottom like that one does, and he seems to be almost standing on his back legs to fetch things out of that tree. So that could well be him. And it would explain why his herd is so relaxed. They are a relaxed herd of elephants normally. This is just brilliant. I can't tell you the feeling that this brings people. Being so close, feeling the earth under our feet. And the sounds of the elephants. Alright, the elephants are now coming around to the right-hand side of your picture. Oh, Nyala. Look at the Nyala. Isn't that cool? There's a Nyala. It's definitely seen us, doesn't care. Red, you want to know if the baby elephants feel pain when their tusks come out? I don't know, Red. I'm going to assume, yes, probably a bit of teething pain. Remember, you know, the kind of pain that human beings feel when they teethe, I think is, it might be slightly unusual, especially given how underdeveloped human being babies are compared with others. And they just can't cope with pain, obviously, they're tiny little things. Elephant is 18 months to 2 years when its tusks erupt. I'm sure there's an element of pain behind it, but it's not debilitating. They don't get endlessly sick and require teething rings and various other interventions for them to produce their teeth. But I'm sure there's an element of pain here. I don't know that they have a temperature like young kids do. Alright, let's go back and see what Brent's doing. We're going to back down off this termite mound and we're going to head off through quarantine clearings and see if we can't pick up tracks of the great queen, Karula.
So, crisis averted. And how did we fix it? Where is it, Dev?
There we are.
There we go. This is how we fixed the crisis. Duct tape or gaffer tape in the film industry it's called. So the great clunking noise was actually created by the stand that we used to hold the bonnet up. And what happened is the little clip that holds the stand in place is broken. So it fell down and hit the fan, and that was like dang, 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 dang. I was actually quite worried. I thought that, oh my goodness, this sounds like the car has died. But we managed to fix it with a bit of gaffer tape. Now, taxons followed tracks of that lioness, and she's gone down into the river system here, so we're going to do the same. There's a little sneaky road, a two-track as we like to call them, that takes us down into the river system. Now, there's a strong possibility she's moved her den site for the cubs from Inyala Road North into the Mawati. So we're gonna go, where's the little sneaky road? Unfortunately, it's there it is. It's a bit harder to see these days since the elephants pushed down a tree across our normal access. Oh, look on the ground. You see it there? So zoom, there we go. Look at that, not a bird you often catch out in the open. And I think our birders will be quite excited. So I did get asked by Safari Dean for a hard quiz. So I think we'll start off a bit easy, and I'm quite sure a lot of our avid birders will be able to identify that bird in two shakes of a lamb's tail. But so what bird is that? It is normally what you call a skulker. And when I say a skulker, it skulks in bushes, and it's not very often we find it out in the open running around on the ground. He's in it. Come on, out into the open again. Yes, oh, it's so pretty. And so it's hunting for insects. And if we look very carefully, you can see there's actually a little curve to the bill, which lets us know its family, although its name is not like the rest of its family, but it is a member. Of the shrike family. Oh, I've got something in my ear. No, stay on the bird, Dave. So, Aubrey's just picked up tracks of the female and the cubs going east. And I'm going to ask him now where it is in a second, but I mean, it's not often we get such an amazing view of this particular bird species. Oh, did he catch something? Yeah, he's got something. Oh, and down the gullet it goes. So I'm very, very excited to see who's going to be the first to identify this little member of the shrike family. Dina would like to know whether it's a cinnamon bun. It's not a cinnamon. Oh, sorry guys, I just need to listen to this. There's quite a few birds around. Sorry, while Dave takes you on a tour around, I just need to be on the radio for a second. Tax. Can I take a standby for that position? Copy, thanks. I'm at Gari, Katlan and Central Junction. So, very exciting. Aubrey has found the Nkuma and the three cubs. And we're on first standby, so we're not in a rush. But look right in front of the vehicle here, Dave, in this there. Can you see them this way? Are they too close? No, there. Right there. Look at that, little blue wax bulls frolicking around, looking for tiny little insects, or mostly looking for grass seed. Now, well done to Joanne, who has got that initial bird correct. It is the black-crowned chagra. So very well done, Joanne. We get two species of chagra in this part of the world. And we get the black-crowned and the brown-crowned. So, Joanne was first, but lots of you have guessed correctly. And we're going to have a quick look. Ooh. Chase it. Catch it. They are just so sweet. The powder blue puffs is how I think of them. And the little blue wax balls. Ooh, nice big grass seed. Actually eating a bit of Erogrostis there. Erogrostis is love grass. After Eros. I can't remember where it's the I think it's the Roman or Greek goddess of love. And that's where that grass gets its name, because the seeds are shaped like a heart. It could be Roman, according to Kirsten in Final Control. I'm a bit lax on my Roman and Greek mythology. Okay, so we're going to start moving now. We'll leave the little wax bulls to eat their love grass. But so there we go. There's the black-crowned chagra. And that's the one we saw on the ground. And we hear, but don't see as often. Oh no, apparently it was Greek. Is the brown-crowned chagra, and they are great skulkers. So it's very unusual to see them nice and out in the open, like we just did. Ooh. Do you hear that, Dev? Ooh. I can hear a Varroa eagle owl, and I think I know exactly which tree it's in. Now, they like to roost in very big trees. And jackalberries being one of their favorites, and there's a massive jackalberry just here, and that sounds like it's coming from that exact jackalberry. Now, one of my favorite memories as a child in Botswana is this massive black maned male lion walking through the Okavango floodplains, and this in the level of mist, and in the background you've got the Varroa eagle. Ooh. standing by orbs. Copy orbs. Confirm best access is still from central. Copy, thanks. So there's the big jackalberry. Now, we're going to have to come back. I'm 98% sure that that eagle owl is there somewhere, but the Nguma and the cubs are about to go into a very thick area, so Aubrey's just called us in. So I will promise for the birders, I'm going to come back and look for that owl, but for the big cat lovers, let's go find some baby cats. So while we race, let's go to a more sedate pace with James on foot.
Now, if you're a predator, of course, what you'll often do is roll about in the dung of another animal, and that, of course, masks your scent. I am not going to roll in this dung, but I am lying in it in order to show you how committed I am to the cause of remaining undetected by the animals around which we are going to be sneaking today. I don't believe I just did this, actually. In Jandro's case, of course, he doesn't need to do this. Jandro, did you wash your hair on leave? No, he didn't. It's actually so... I can't tell you how nice this stuff smells. You know, I'm not going to roll in it. Normally what happens is a predator will go and lie down, often in buffalo dung, which is wet and disgusting, and they'll roll about in that, and then they smell like buffalo dung as opposed to nasty lion or leopard. And if you happen to be a nyala or an impala or a bushbuck or a steenbok or a duiker, you won't pick up on the fact that you're about to be devoured by a sort of shadow that smells like buffalo dung. Let's move on. Herbert is watching this lot going, those people are off their heads. Oh, Shamsung, you say we see many trees that have fallen over, and you're wondering how many of that is, or how much of that is due to termites rather than elephants. It's almost exclusively due to elephants. Well, let's take a look at this tree here. I'm Jandro. This tree here, okay, is now being eaten by termites. Here's their little mound. Fungus-growing termite, Macrotermes natalensis. But it was unquestionably pushed over by elephants. Now, the elephants have opened up a whole ecosystem here for other animals to live in. We've got bracket fungus at the bottom of my stick here, Jandro. That's a fungus there. The only reason that fungus is able to grow where it is because the bark has been torn off here. And the bark was initially torn off, if you come to the right there, Jandri, by elephants. This would have been torn off by elephants. That would have opened it up for wood-boring beetles. You can see they've bored into the wood there. Or possibly a carpenter bee. They will also dig into the wood and also... woodpeckers and things, but I think this has happened post-mortem, as it were, after the tree was pushed over. And so this was definitely pushed over by elephants. The termites have then come into it. They've got into it. Remember, the bark is an exceptionally important covering for trees, and the bark protects it from fire, it protects it from termites, it protects it from wood-boring beetles and their larvae and that sort of thing. Once the bark goes, of course, quickly go over to Brent and have a look at these special things.
So guys, look at this. Thanks to Aubrey, the Nguma, lioness, and the three little cubs. Oh, look at that, this is so exciting. This is the first time I've seen them. Oh my goodness, they are adorable. So we're just gonna move forward a little bit so the other cars can also see. And I'm just gonna stop and let her walk towards us with those three glorious little babies. Now, she is about to go into a very thick area, and she's about to drop down into the drainage line. I can't help myself. If you hear many, many clicks, it's my camera. And I hope you guys are getting screenshots of these incredible little babies. Look at that. Oh, she's just... I need to change all my settings from last night. Now, I know one thing James and I agree on, that little lion cubs are possibly the cutest thing in the world. They you lazy lion. Look at them, aren't they just cute? Well done, Mom. They are just absolutely amazing little creatures. At the moment, they're about the size of a domestic house cat. Look at that, she's going to walk right between the Djuma vehicles. Look at them, off they go. Oh, I didn't even manage to snap a shot. But she's about to go into the river system. Now, strangely enough, she's heading into the same river system where I saw Karula's cubs when they were a few hours old. Now, of course, me being me, I have one or two tricks up my sleeve. And one of the beautiful things about not being in Maggie the Mahindra is we're a little bit more maneuverable. So I think I can get a car into this river system. Can you see them through there, Dev? You see them? No. Okay, we're gonna just pop past. I'm just trying to figure out where we are, where's the big tree, how to get into the river here. And isn't this absolutely exciting? Nkuhuma cubs, my first sighting. And so I'm going to get into this riverbed, and while I do that, and of course I'm going to leave Dave attached to a thorn tree on my way through, let's go across to James, who's got a beautiful sunrise.
I'd love to say that I have a beautiful sunrise shot, everybody. Actually, Gendre and his very artistic eye have spotted an unbelievable amount of, what would we call those? We would call them crepuscular rays, wouldn't we? Now, the interesting thing is that they are obviously, they don't look parallel, do they? They look like they're coming from one point in the sky. And what is interesting is that they are actually parallel. They are precisely parallel. And the reason they look like that is for the same reason that two parallel railway lines look like they're converging in the distance. So if you watch two parallel railway lines and you're on a straight railway line, you know that they're parallel. You know that they don't actually meet. But as they go towards the horizon, you see them meeting up. That's exactly the case with these things here, and that's why always with these crepuscular rays, whether they're coming from the western horizon, the eastern horizon, or this one looks like from straight above, that's just the angle of the clouds to make it look like that, they're completely parallel. And those that are still subscribed to the idea that the Earth is flat will tell you that, or that the Sun is actually much closer to us than we have been led to believe by conspiracy, the keepers of the knowledge, shall we say, the Illuminati of the world. They'll tell you that the sun is actually like a lamp shining over the earth, and it's proved by the fact that these lines are not parallel. In actual fact, they are completely parallel. So if you happen to be slightly dissuaded or slightly doubtful that the earth is round and that the sun is quite a long way away from us, be not dissuaded any longer. Isn't that a stunning, stunning view? Great big slices of golden sunlight dropping down to the earth. I'd love to say that that was my my words, but I stole them from a book I read, I'm afraid. Great slices of golden sunlight. Stunning. All right, we're going to turn around. Herbie's just up here. I'm not entirely sure. Oh, there he is. And we're walking along where we think maybe Karula went. We haven't found any of her tracks yet. Herbert is currently fossicking underneath a log to see if he can find us a scorpion or a millipede or a centipede or maybe even a snake. Let's see what he's found. Of course, the great joy of walking with Herbert is, well, apart from the fact that you feel safe, you learn a huge amount about the medicinal and local uses of plants out here. So hopefully we'll do a few more of those today. I'll go on to... Okay, nothing here. Justin, you want to know if there are edible fungi here? Yes, there are, and you want to know if what their names are. I'm going to be facetious now. Their names are... mushrooms. Justin, that's a very facetious answer. There are many different kinds of mushrooms that you can eat, in much the same way as there are in other parts of the world. I don't know any of their names. I know that there's some poisonous ones. I know one or two of their names, but the edible ones I don't know the names of, but there are lots that you can find. Especially in the part of the world where the only ones I've ever eaten wild here come from a part of the world where genre is quite closely associated, and that's a place called Stellenbosch. And you find them there in the exotic poplar plantations. You'll find lots of wild mushrooms there that are very delicious to eat. We're walking through very, very pleasant woodland that would be very nervous to do in summer because it would be quite thick. But you can see how it's really opening up around us as the leaves fall. And I always think that, and I might be wrong here, having not experienced too many Northern Hemisphere winters, that the trees here lose their leaves relatively late because come the middle of winter, I mean, we're now going towards, we're in midwinter, you would imagine that all of the leaves would already not have their leaves on them. And certainly in Johannesburg that's the case. But here, they maintain their leaves till probably about August, and then the winds come and blow them off. And then September and October is when it looks like a very wintry landscape, although the temperature goes up. I always think that's quite interesting. Let's see what else Herbie's got here for us. Basically turning over every dry log to see if we can find something underneath it. In the meantime, Chandra, she tripped over this little stick here, everybody. This is the only stick within how did you even hit that? Chandra, of course, is the most more accident-prone person I've ever met in my life. Please don't stand on another rusty nail, hoppy pus foot. Now, this is the silver cluster leaf tree. And the silver cluster leaf tree is a very important source of forage at this time of the year. You don't have to come under here. I'll bring it to you, Jean-Marie. Fussy boots. Very important source of forage this time of the year. During the summer months, you won't find much eating this at all. But now, with there being not much else to eat, just listening, you will find lots of animals eating this. And you can make quite a nice string out of the bark. You peel it off. In fact, Herbert is the one who should be doing this, but I'll try and show you how to do it. While I do this, Paperboy Johnny, you want to know about... there we go. Look at that, I didn't even need my knife, I just took it out to show you how manly I am. Paperboy Johnny, you want to know about what snakes we get here, and we get lots and lots of different kinds of snakes here. The most obvious ones are the ones you would have heard of, were the dreadfully terrifying black mamba, and they of course are found here in fairly great profusion. Then you get something called a puff adder. They're the most commonly seen snakes because they're a bit lazy. They're like lions. And then we get lots of other things. Tree snakes, which is the most toxic snake or poisonous snake in Africa. Venomous snake in Africa. Then we get, what else do we have? African rock pythons, beautiful kinds of snakes. And we get things like yellow-bellied sand snakes and striped-bellied sand snakes. I'm just running through them as I try and make my rope here for you. I know what's going to happen here is Herbert is going to arrive. and take over from me and embarrass me horribly. Right, there we are. So you take three strands like that, okay? And this is a particularly good tree for it. And then you plait them together. Now, I don't know how many of you can plait. Can you plait, Chandra? You should be able to, given your hair. Tie them in a knot at the end, like that. Okay, I'll make you a little bracelet, Chandra, shall I? Like Herbert made for Jamie the other day and didn't make me one. And then we plait them together. One for one. Oh, no, I've only got two strands suddenly. It's going to look so terrible. Wait, everyone. I will get there. Brent is still repositioning. Thank you, Irette, as you say. Are all South Africans this kooky? Or am I just a unicorn of humanity? William? Herbert has said something. I didn't quite catch it. I think you'll find that quite a few South Africans are quite kooky in some ways. I think you might find that I'm slightly more eccentric than most. Chandra thinks, yes, I'm definitely much more eccentric than most South Africans would be. I don't think I come out of the draw of normality, no. I'm very happy that you think I'm like a unicorn. Some would say I'm much more like a less pleasant rarity in life, but I'm very happy to be a unicorn, Iratus. Thank you so much. All right, here we go. We've almost got some rope here, Chandra. Almost got a piece of rope long enough to use as a tow rope. Now, in somebody else's competent hands, everyone, this would be quite impressive. But you see how I'm plaiting, Chandra. And see how competent I am at plaiting. I will not touch your hair. I will not touch your hair without a valid tetanus shot. Now, there's the rope. You see? It's not very neat, but it is actually quite effective. And that is the silver cluster leaf tree, and it's quite an effective rope-making tree. I'm quite impressed with myself there. Thought of that off the cuff there, Chandra. There we go. Okay, come on then, everybody. While Brent is still trying to negotiate his way into a very thick drainage line, if anyone's going to get a car in there, Brent will. Whether he'll get it out again or not is another matter entirely. But with any luck, he'll get it in there and you'll have a nice view of those lions. Now, we just need to find Herbert and find out where he's gone. Because I suspect he's found something. I heard a grunt from the bushes. I hope that wasn't a grunt of distress. I don't think it was. Now what you do here is you look around. When you don't see him, you go... and then you get a reply. On we go. Now, Brent is still looking for the lions, but go and get an update from him. We'll try and find Herbert and we'll catch up with you just now.
So we're very confident that lioness has come into this area. If we have a look around us, it's ideal for cubs. And you can see there's lots of little, there we go, little holes and drainage lines. It's a great place for her to keep the cubs. I think she's in these quarry thickets ahead. We've checked that no tracks have come past. So we're gonna give it a quick squiz. And if we have no luck here, there's tracks of Karula to follow next. And they're heading down Central Road to the east. So what we want to do here is, wherever I find a little bit of open ground like this, I'm just making sure there are no lion tracks, and there aren't, which is good. Sorry. Okay, I just got to be on the Game Drive channel. Okay, so Aubrey's found her. I think he's just to the north of us. I know exactly where she is. Okay. Dave,
yep.
Don't get caught in the thorn tree. I'll try to keep Dave out of the thorns. I can't guarantee. I'm just going to push this quarry a little bit so I can... Ooh. How rude. And there we go. We can get past it now. Just got to be on the game drive for a second. Ah, there's Orby. I don't need to be on the game drive. I found him. So she's right here somewhere. Now, this is ideal spot for her to leave the cubs. I'm just gonna... there's Orby, so she's just in front of Orby. Now, we've got the luck of having a small vehicle. We might be able to move around onto the little peninsula that's over here. And we're probably going to be able to get a view from the other side, but it is going to take some maneuvering. But we should be with her. Wait, Orby's on. Let me just chat to Orbs quickly. Orbs, do you think it's better if I go to the other side of the Shkova? Orby says this is very, very, very thick. It's very difficult. But we're going to try. So while we try and maneuver to get another view of the Djuma and her cub, so exciting, we're going to go to James, who's on foot.
I'm very pleased that Brently Smith was smacked in the head there by a branch. I feel that's the universe telling him something, really. There is the exoskeleton of a little scorpion, and I suspect, as with the last one that I found, this is an olive. What's it? Olive burrowing. A what? Olivencia, yes, but the common name, the olive burrowing scorpion, I think it's called. I'd never know, remember if it's the olive bark or olive burrowing scorpion, but there it is. Now, olive bark, says Jean-André, the resident. Aranidae expert. Okay, so olive bark it is. Thank you, Jean-André. He says pleasure, and I'll hit him with my stick afterwards when we're off air again. And you can see there that he's quite a nasty little fellow. He's got a thick tail and very thin little pincers. And I know that we all often tell you about this, but the reason that it's important is that obviously the tail, therefore, is more important to him when he is killing things than are the little pathetic pincers on the front of his body. And I think it's absolutely astounding that the scorpion managed to climb out of this exoskeleton in one piece. How on earth did it manage to do that without tearing the whole thing apart? I don't know, is the answer. It came out where the mouth is, basically, and somehow managed to pull all eight legs. It's an arachnid, remember, so it's got eight legs. All eight legs out, and the tail intact, and leave this perfectly intact thing here. Now, what we don't want to do, of course, is sit on the adult version of what just made that. He's not alone over here. There are termites all over here. And these, if I'm not mistaken, are not fungus-growing termites, or certainly not the mound-building fungus-growing termites, and that's because I can't find a mound around here. But they will often forage about in a place like this and then take the dead wood. They sort of set up a temporary home here, and they eat away at the wood, and then they'll disappear again once the wood is finished. And if you look over here, you can see where they've eaten the wood. They've covered it up with soil, and underneath that soil, they've eaten away at the wood. And John, if you look right where my stick is, you can see a freshly sort of excavated piece of the wood there. There they are. You see it there. They're just going into the hole there. I think that's rather remarkable. Now, one of the reasons they do this, they build this sandy thing, is to stay away from the sun. I'm slightly distracted, everybody, because Brent has found the cubs.
Well, a cub is a strong point. You can see movement behind a bush. Wait, there we go. So all three are suckling at the moment. Now, she has chosen a good spot to stop. There's lots of little hidey spots for the cubs if she leaves them. Thirsty little blighters. And I'm surveying the surrounding landscape, and there is a chance that I'm going to be able to maneuver to the other side of this deep hole. And if you have a look off the side here, it's a good 10 feet down to the bottom, but there's a little peninsula on the opposite side, and the cubs are actually in where they're, no, there. No, they're more to the right there, Dev. Dev's lost the lions now. There they are. Oh, look at that! Hello, monster! Who's coming to inspect us? So what we're going to do is, I'm pretty sure it's going to take me about 5 or 6 minutes, but I can maneuver around next to them. Oh, you can hear them. I'm just going to keep very, very quiet for a second. You can just hear them, this little... They're growling at each other while they're suckling. Listen to that. Isn't that incredible? Very upset with each other. Guys, there's six teeth. No need for argument. Look at that. Wow. So upset with each other. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to try and get ourselves into a better position. Of course, as you can see, there's a fair amount of worry between us and the lions. And I'm just checking. I'm pretty sure I can get there. And hopefully we'll have a bit more of a gap. Cubs! So exciting! Oh, they're just two gorgeous foreheads. They are absolutely... I think the only way to describe these cubs is delectable. But while we try to get into a better position to view the delectable little monsters, let's go see what James is up to.
Delectable monsters, really? Okay. Jen B, I believe you've been very distracted by the dry and chapped skin on my lips, which we thought we'd give you a nice close-up of. There you go. Sorry about that, Jen. I think I need to put some stuff on my lippies, obviously. I do apologize. Right, now, come over here. Now, don't trip over this stuff, Chandra. This is the kind of thing you will fall over and stab yourself to death on. This is the sort of impenetrable forest of Strychnos madagascarensis. And I thought until very recently only the fruit was a useful thing at all, until Herbert told me, no, and this is one of the joys of walking with him, you can take the roots of this tree, the Strychnos madagascarensis, which is a not particularly unattractive tree, and you, if you've got a child with a birthmark, and you all know how disfiguring birthmark can be, if you've got a child with a birthmark, what you do is that you take the root, not the leaf, like this. I'm just showing you the venation on the leaf. Can you see it's got three veins from the base? That's how you know what it is. It's easily identifiable as Strychnos, with those obvious three veins from the base there. You take their roots and you burn them up and you powder the ash, and then you mix them with either wild medlar roots or gwari berry roots or white berry bush roots. Those are the three kinds of plants that you could use. And then you make little incisions over the birthmark and you rub that into the incisions, and apparently it heals really nicely. I'm not sure what kind of birthmarks exactly, some probably skin diseases or something like that that comes with being born, and the earliness of life. And that apparently is a very effective way of getting rid of those little ailments and lesions, and that's quite important, because otherwise it would be a tree I would think was almost worthless to this area. Now Shamsung, you want me to explain the difference between poisonous and venomous again? Well, yes, I can certainly do that. Poisonous means something that if you ingest, i.e. eat it, it's going to cause you to it's going to cause bad effects. It might kill you, it might just make you vomit a little bit. But venomous means something that will envenomate. In other words, that will create some kind of toxic effect in your body. And so to envenomate would be to introduce a toxin into the body. Let's just have a look here, Gendre, if you don't mind. It would be to introduce a toxin into the body through the into the blood or the nervous system, the endocrine system, and sort of poison the body from within. And that's different from eating something poisonous. So something that is venomous can envenomate. It can, something that is poisonous will poison you, but that's normally through ingestion. Now, can you see this track? Is it viewable? This is a white-tailed mongoose track, everyone. Now, the white-tailed mongoose is quite a special mongoose. It's the biggest mongoose that we get here, and that's a real snake eater. They will definitely eat snakes if they can get hold of them. It's probably the size, it's probably about that long. That's the same length as my stick, just about, which is about 1.5 feet. It's about the length of a white-tailed mongoose, excluding tail. So they are quite large mongoose. And they walk along, and the real indicator that this is a white-tailed mongoose is the fact that if you look very closely and very carefully, you can see out in front of the track are the four claw marks. They've got very, very long, sharp claws. Slightly blunter than a cat's at the end, but much longer. And blunter because they're out all the time. Unlike a cat's, of course, which are not out all the time. They are protractable. On we go, Andre. Brent is just trying to reposition so he can get another view of those little cubs, those delectable monsters. Ooh. Here is an extremely unusually large example of Strychnos madagascarensis. And this will make very nice fruit. So a tree this size, if the elephants don't get to it first, which I suspect they will make very nice fruit. It'll get very tall, not very tall, but as tall as that, and make a nice round crown. And it produces big green balls of fruit. And those big green balls of fruit, when they're ripe, you can open up and you can eat the fruit straight. Don't eat the seeds, because they're full of strychnine, and that will result in being poisoned as opposed to envenomated. And that can, I don't think there's enough to kill you, but it certainly is not very good for you. But you can take the flesh and dry it and mix it with honey, and apparently it's delicious if you mix it with honey. I'm going to walk continuously at this angle, because if you could see how Gendre is walking now in order to make the shot that he's taking smooth and not trip over something, you would be that. Let me just show you what he was doing, everyone. This is important to know. This is the kind of thing that he has to do in order to make sure that you get a smooth picture and you don't trip over something. He's very professional, as I was wondering. Yeah, you just keep walking behind me like that. I'm having a thoroughly good time watching you. Okay, come on, don't be silly. Susan, you say, is it safe for me out here when Herbert disappears? Yes, it's safe for me even if Herbert wasn't here. And the only reason we have Herbert is because it means that I can then look you in the eye when I'm talking to you. I don't have to stare around all the time. I know where Herbert's gone. I can see his tracks on the road. I know he's going down there in order to try and find Karula's tracks. That's what we're hoping to find. So I'm just going to follow along the way he's gone. He's not far ahead. So I'm pretty sure that within this area here, there isn't anything that is likely to cause our demise. And I mean, that doesn't mean I'm not aware of what's going on, but yeah, it's completely safe. And it's always safe, you know. It's a big misnomer that being out here is a massively dangerous thing to do. It's not if you're aware. If you're unaware, then it can be dangerous. And we had quite an interesting incident yesterday where we all went for a run, and there were a few guests in camp, and two of them just took off, sort of went off in front, and that's dangerous because that's just not, you know, they're people that are unfamiliar with the area, and so it becomes quite difficult or becomes quite dangerous. As long as you're aware of what the threats are, it's pretty cool. Okay, the cubs, those delectable monsters, have been refound.
So we are with the delectable monsters, and Dave is in a bush, but it's worth it because of the little monster. So we've managed to get to her, and unfortunately they're still in the thicket, but we are quite a bit closer. Now I'm just going to try roll forward. I reckon if I can get 10 centimeters further than where we are, we're going to get the best view. Of course, I'm quite worried about being stuck here because there's no real way out. Here we go. Look at that! Oh, eat it! That one seems to be the bravest because it actually started stalking us. We were trying to maneuver through the bush. A little, yeah, is it? Look how tired. It's a tired kitty. So as I said, if you want to know how big these lion cubs are, they're about the same size as a domestic husky. Except even a cub this size, if we got into an argument with a domestic house cat, it would. Oh, it's just too gorgeous. Now, this is what I've seen. I, at the moment, I can't tell how many boys, how many girls. I think what we're looking at is a little boy. And that's purely based on behavior. Look at that. Oh, it's a tired kitty. Now, of course it's a boy because it's got its tongue half stuck out of its mouth while it goes to sleep. I'm pretty sure that's a little boy. I can't really tell the other two. Oh, here comes another one. So it's coming. It's coming. Oh, it's going to lie down. Go. Oh, they are just too wonderful. I'm so happy that I decided to leave Torchwood and decide Djuma was the place to be. Oh, I'm going to chew a stick. So of course they are teething to a degree. They're going to lose their milk teeth quite quickly. And in the middle of a thicket drainage line, and I know we're going black screen, but should I try move back a little bit, a bit higher?
Yep.
Okay, we're just gonna try move back a couple of centimeters. See, now this is very important, you notice? They reacted when I started the car. But I'm gonna let the car run for a second. And here we go, you can see naughty little monsters. Just try back a bit. Move when I touch the branch. Ooh. I'm not sure whether you can okay, picture's back, there we go. Look at that. And I do apologize for the back being time these little guys. If you hear my camera clicking away, it's just because I can't help myself.
Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gauri repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
I hope you didn't get my little gormless face there, everybody. Brent lost signal, I'm afraid. You're stuck with me again. Kirsten said, please find frame, so I went, which is a beautiful picture, and I hope you didn't see it. Screen grabs of my lovely face. We're walking down towards where the gauri repeater, and you can see it sitting over there. And what I'll just explain what that is quickly, and then we'll talk about some more biology. It's over there. It's a tower on which there are a number of important pieces of equipment that allow us to be able to send you a high definition signal from the middle of the African wilderness. And that goes, the signal goes from the camera into Jean-Ray's backpack. I hope I didn't break anything. Out of an aerial there, gets sent straight to there. That then bounces over to the final control, down into the final control, through a couple of computers like that. Then it goes up into a satellite dish and through the universe to London, and from London everywhere else. And that process takes approximately, apparently, I think there's a delay of less than 30 seconds. So from what I'm saying to you now to when you're receiving it everywhere else in the world, 20 seconds or so? Unbelievable. Anyway, that's how it works. Now, the Brent has found some signal. Let's go back to the cubs.
So that's Mom there, and you can... And we do apologize, but she has chosen a wonderful spot for the cubs. But of course, that is not the best spot in the world for our signal. And as you can see, so two of the cubs are directly behind her, but the one is keeping a very close eye on us. And it's about half a meter closer than Mom is to us, giving us the lion's eye through the thicket. The other two look like they're suckling again, and unfortunately her back is to us, so that is the cub we can see at the moment. There we go, and just see that, oh no, what are they up to back there? Not suckling, playing, wrestling with each other. Look, so glorious. Now, we're going to stay here for a little bit, but I think we're probably going to leave her. I'm pretty sure she's going to be here. Oh, wait. No, going to snooze. Oh, wait, that. Sorry, Dave. Back at the back. Now, James has apparently named these cubs Jerry, Louise, and Kirsty. And I think there's a male involved, so it's going to be a bit interesting. He's going to have, he's going to be confused. We probably could call male Jerry, but Jerry is obviously Geraldine. Hello. Now that's the one I think is a little male. And And you can see that little white in the corner of the eye. That's just dust buildup. Oh, I can't help myself. Clickety click 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 through the bushes. Well, hi Terry. Terry is in Oklahoma, and Terry would like to know, what is the probability of all three of these cubs and Karula's cubs surviving to maturity? Now, if you take the law of averages out in the bush, it's not very good, unfortunately. Leopard and lion cubs have about a 75% mortality rate until they reach a year old. So once they're a year old, well, with leopards, their mortality rate drops to almost sort of 10-12%. So it's very unlikely after they reach a year. But lion cubs, even after their year, lion cubs only reach that sort of stage when they're about 3 years old. And that's due to the fact of the male lion coalition takeovers, and that the fact that a male lion's reign at the top, the reign supreme, is a lot shorter than a male leopard's. So it's if we take it, the chances are more than likely, and I would love to be wrong on this, is that only one out of these three cubs is going to survive to maturity. Now, with the Birmingham boys being a big and strong coalition, it's possible that all three will survive, but over lions in general in this area, if we speak about mean averages, it's more than likely only one of the three will survive to maturity. Of course, I hope I'm decidedly wrong, but unfortunately nature is a very harsh place. Now, Michael's posed a very, very interesting question. What would happen if the Birmingham boys found these cubs without the lioness? Would they know that they're theirs? Being where we are, which is sort of the core of the Birmingham's territory, they probably would. But the Birmingham's being first-time fathers, it's very difficult to say. But from what I've heard from the other guides and how they react with the Styx cubs, I think there wouldn't be a problem. So if they hadn't had interactions with other cubs, is always the possibility they might eat them. And male lions are well known for eating their own offspring, but it seems like the Birminghams are not that type of male lion at the moment. So fortunately, I think it'll all be happy days. But you never know till it happens. That's the thing out here. I mean, what a way to come back from leave. I mean, in Kahumas and male lion last night, and then I'm just absolutely ecstatic to be able to see these little delectable monsters. And Safari Dean's wondering, at what age does the male start outgrowing his siblings? Probably about around now we might start noticing a slight difference, but in a month or so it'll be a very noticeable difference. Well, not very, but start getting taller in the shoulder. And from behavior, it's generally the best way to tell. Now, I'm by no means sure that it's one male and two females. I haven't actually been able to have a good enough look, and as you can see, we're right in the middle of a thicket. But just from behavior, and I said I might be wrong, from behavior it looks like one male, and the other two maybe females, or maybe there's a shy male. So I can't say for certain what the sexes of the cubs are yet, but with her being on Djuma, we've got a really good chance of being able to decipher that little conundrum, and hopefully we'll maybe even be able to decipher it on the sunset safari. Hello, Jennifer. And Jennifer is wondering about incest in lions, and will male cubs mate with their siblings? Males, given the chance, will mate with their mothers, believe it or not. And incest in big cats is actually not that uncommon. And with lions, they can inbreed for up to six generations without any medical defects or problems. But after that, it becomes a very big problem. You start getting stunted growth and very strange things like that. But in an open system like this, which we're open to like 8.5 million acres of Greater Kruger National Park and Transfrontier Park, that the genetics move around enough. So it's very uncommon for a male lion to stay for multiple generations. So normally, and if we look at the Matimbas, who used to be the dominant males in this area, when their current set of cubs with the Inkahumans, which is now the female who started mating, so she's just under 4 now. So male lion tenure sort of only lasts 4 or 5 years. And in very extreme cases, it goes longer than that. And in that way, it's how that they stop incest, that a new bunch of males sort of come in every, on average, and it's not obviously not an exact science, every 4 years. And that sort of stops incest. But in rare cases, they do mate with their daughters. But it's not as big a problem with lions, and especially not in an open system like this. So it looks like the Inkahuma little family is going to sleep. And we're probably going to try find a way out of here shortly. We're just going to leave them be for a while. Mom's asleep, and all three cubbies are asleep. Oh, Mom's just lifted her ears when I said she was asleep. And don't think we're going to see too much more movement here at the
moment. Little bits of nectar. What's Chandra just went, What does that mean?
I was singing for you, Jeff.
Singing for me. Don't. So I think that's a moth. But it's very difficult to tell. It's very small. And I don't want to pull it out. But isn't it amazing? I just think that these incredible shots that we can get of these things, absolutely unbelievable. I think that's so special. Now let's just examine the rest of this plant, because it's one of the... I have shown you this WildEarthTV many times, but very few of them are in this condition this time of the year. So let's see if we can't find a crab spider perhaps, or a mantis disguised as a WildEarthTV flower. Certainly, if I was Stefan, I'm pretty sure I would have found many kinds of crab spiders on this thing by now.
There's a thread that just came off.
Is there? A thread?
Not a web.
A web. I don't think I'm that blind that I wouldn't have seen one there. Sorry about that, everybody. Apparently the stream went off for about a minute. What we're doing is investigating WildEarthTV flower. I'm not sure how... Did you get our moth? Do you think, Kirsten? Do you think they saw our moth? It's very important. You did see our moth, thank goodness. Let's just quickly look down the rest of the length of this plant and see what other creatures are going to be on it. And because it's one of the last sort of bits of moisture around here, one would expect to find a few more interesting bits and pieces, but all there is that one lonely little moth. Chandra, do you know what it feels like to be a lonely little moth?
I do, James.
You do? Me too. This is the oddest bushwalk I've ever been on. I'm going to look at one more WildEarthTV flower, just simply because I think we're going to find some things on them. No, not on this one. We'll have a look at this grass instead. Now, this grass, I'm not entirely sure of the name of, but you can still see the seeds on it, right? You've got those seeds. And those seeds are a massively, massively important source of forage at this time of the year. Normally, there'd be a lot more of these sorts of grasses around holding these seeds. And for the little birds like the waxbills and the pytilias and the firefinches and the widow finches, they'd have these seeds to eat throughout the winter. But now, of course, because we had such a poor rainy season before this, very few of these grasses have actually got seeds on them. And so there's much less for everything to eat. Gendre is squatting at the most appalling angle, everybody. It really is. It's quite something to behold. It's very distracting. One just has to get used to him again once he's back from leave, you see. Just be quiet and keep walking. Here's an actual Waltheria flower, and it's the crab spider. If we ever actually manage to find one, I'll be so happy if I do. There's the flower, and the crab spiders that live on them disguise themselves almost exactly like that. So they look precisely like the flower, with a bit of the sort of old flower attached to them. I think it's really... Oh, there is one there. What's that? It's a flower, an old flower. I thought it was a spider. Damn. All right, let's not embarrass myself any further by looking at Waltheria flowers. Right, let's see what else we can find here. Now, many of you, of course, know that Jamie Patterson is an exceptional flautist. Not that any of you have heard her play the flute. But not a flute, but in also part of the woodwind section in the orchestra, is the clarinet. Now, this is actually an amazing thing to have found. Were you to want to make yourself a clarinet, this wood is fantastic. It's a zebra wood. It's called Dalbergia melanoxylon. It's really hard. And inside heartwood is the most stunning black color. That's why it's called a zebra wood. But you don't normally find it in pieces this large, because the elephants destroy it. It's normally very, very small, scraggly, nasty sort of bush. And I wonder if in here we wouldn't find some nice heartwood. I think it's probably a bit hard. It's harder than leadwood, so to get into it is really difficult. But once you can get a piece of this stuff, you've got a clarinet for life. And if you look over here, you can see how it's been broken many times by the elephants. It's been eaten away, and even many times this season it's been eaten. But it has grown. It's done rather well, and you'd get a really beautiful piece of wood out of that where you should come and chop it down, which we are obviously not going to do. Now, miff? Ah, miss. Right. Sorry, I missed your name there, miss. I thought it was miff. That's because Kirsten McLennan Smith is from Durban and doesn't speak English. You say, are there any baobab trees around here? Miss, there aren't any baobab trees. The southernmost baobab tree, or the biggest and most southern baobab tree, that was Jean-Ré walking into a tree, is found about 70 kilometers north of here on a farm called Giraffe Farm, which is in the Timbavati, which is also a collection of private nature reserves like the Sabi Sand in which we find ourselves now. And there are two big baobabs there. There's one in Hoedspruit, which is just to the west of that position, and then not much until you go up further north. Around Palaboa, there are plenty of them. In the Olifants Valley, the valley of the Olifants River, you'll find a few baobab trees. And then once you get north of the Letaba River, which is kind of, I'd say it's probably, Herbert's found something. It's probably, it's probably about sort of two-thirds of the way up the Kruger Park. Then you get hundreds of them. And if you ever want to see scenery, wildlife, so I'm going to stop falling over. Scenery, wildlife, and unbelievable baobab trees. Mapungubwe is the place to go. That's the northern parts of the Kruger National Park. It's absolutely stunning. Sorry, not Kruger, Pafuri. I mean northern parts of the Kruger National Park. There you get baobabs all over the place. These huge canyons. It really is quite stunning. We're going across to Brent. I don't know what he's got. What's he got? Elephants. Let's go and have a look.